Welcome. I want to give you a very warm welcome to Breakfast at the Virtual Bath. And I'm delighted to introduce artist and friend, Tracey Moffatt, who is visiting with us all the way from Sydney. Hi, Tracey.
Hello. Hello, Silvia. Buenos dias.
Great to have you. Buenos dias. So it is breakfast at the Bass, having my coffee right now.
Cafe.
However, I want to point out that it is 1 a.m. in Sydney. Are you having a midnight snack?
Lemon tea.
Lemon tea. That's perfect. Wonderful. So let's jump right into conversation. The first thing I want to bring up, which you sent me, which I think is amazing, is your art TV, the Art Calls. And it was 2014, you were interviewing artists on Skype for Australian TV.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about that and whether you are some sort of fortune teller that you would guess that 6 years later, we would be doing this all the time.
Yes, yes. So it was an idea for a pilot for a TV show, and it was made on no money, and it was part of an exhibition I had at the big State Museum, Queensland Art Gallery, in 2014. It was an art piece. I'm going to make a fake TV show. I'm going to do it by Skype. It became an hour long, two half-hour episodes, very funny, very irreverent. I called Deb Cass in New York. I called Franco Mondini Ruiz in San Antonio, Texas, and artists around Australia and so on. And it was unserious.
But it was serious in certain moments. And
yeah.
How it went from unserious to truly, let's talk about your art, to very serious. Actually, I'll bring up something that I really enjoyed seeing, and it's a little bit, you know, it's quite poetic. You were talking to fashion designer Jenny Key.
Yeah.
We're talking about the fact that I think in the 70s, she would dress up in really amazing, extravagant ways. You were talking specifically about a cat suit. And I told her how generous of her to let us see her.
Yes.
And I think that's so amazing to talk about generosity, especially these days, when artists are generously going online with museums and other collectors and allowing us to see you.
Yes.
A comment about that?
Yeah, it's a very generous thing, isn't it? Well, you know, the famous one was Andy Warhol, who just went out to every party. You know, you read the diaries and he just went out and he was seen. And that's a great thing. But for me, I want my work seen. I don't particularly want to be seen. I avoid interviews. For me, it's the work. The work must get out.
Absolutely.
I don't look on social media or anything. I don't do Instagram. I guess I should.
Well, I think you should do whatever makes you happy, especially these days. And we're certainly happy to be seeing you and talking to you. So I'm going to rewind and I'm going to say a little bit about you. So you were born in Brisbane, Australia, and you're a film.
Don't say the year.
What?
We're not talking about the years. We're not.
No. I'm not mentioning years. I won't even mention your exhibition years if you don't want. That's okay. I get it. photography and video. You were in Cannes Film Festival in 90 and 93, which I find amazing because you have this crossover between a film artist and a museum artist. So I remember your 2017 Venice Biennial exhibition. Yes. I note here that you're the first Australian Indigenous artist to represent Australia. But yes. As I was looking at your bio, it was 2017, but you also participated in the Biennial in 97. And the Biennial of Sydney, 93, 96, 2008, Singapore, 11, Sao Paulo, 98, Gwangju, 95. Do you want me to keep going? Because there's a lot more.
A lot more.
You know what? It's lots of really good museums, but let's talk about the Dia Center for the Arts in 97, which you told me brought to you the United States for 12 years. Tell us about that. Why you decided?
It was so prestigious to be invited to have an exhibition at DIA Center for the Arts. DIA. When you were invited, you got to have a show for 9 months. So your work was up in the galleries for 9 months, and I knew it was time to move to New York. That was a cue. That was bye-bye Australia, and off to amazing New York. And, of course, I've always been such a fan of the city, in love with the city, and knew it was the time for me to be there. And I lived there for 12 years. It's so incredible. I was like Andy Warhol. I went out every night. But of course, you know, you're meeting artists from all walks of life. So I miss that a little bit. I love Sydney. It's lively. And I have friends and so on. But I miss the vibe, the New York vibe.
So I know I promised I wasn't going to ask you for dates, but I have to ask you where you went out in New York, because I imagine.
Anywhere that we could go, any free party. And that's why New York is so, you know, so open. You'd be invited to some fancy art dealer's place on the Upper East Side for an event, for drinks. And then by the end of the night, you're down town on the Lower East Side at some dive. You know, that's all in the one night. You go from high culture to low culture. It's all, that's New York, you know, and it embraces you. Yeah. You know, I didn't want to be a tourist. I wanted to be a New Yorker. I still consider myself one, and I'm very sad about New York at the moment. Yeah. And the virus and the illnesses and I've been chanting at night for the virus to go away.
We're all sad, but I think New York always bounces back. So we'll get to rediscover those sort of one night going from super fancy to super divey, because I think that's our experience in New York, which is really wonderful. Speaking of partying, this morning you sent me a picture of you, two pictures, great pictures of you partying at the Sydney Biennial. When was that? Is that recent?
Yeah, it's right now, and it was the party the last week, just before lockdown in March this year, early March. All the international artists came to Sydney. It's a big deal, the Sydney Biennale. So we had the fancy party at my art dealer's mansion on Sydney Harbour. Rosalind and Tony Oxley are my art dealers here, and they always have a big fancy party in their Gothic Revival mansion. And all the artists, we had such a great time. But then a week later, we had to all isolate. So the Biennale has hardly been seen. We had to close it down, and it's a shame. Many of the artists were transgender, First Nations, Indigenous, or gay. There's hardly anyone white and straight in the whole Biennale. The director, Brooke Andrews, is First Nations himself, so it's a wild Biennale, and I hope we will get to some, the restrictions will be lifted and we'll get to see the show.
Do you think that they'll extend the show a little bit so that people get to see it?
I'll hope so. I mean, now, I think so. It's a possibility.
There's so much good art that's locked in museums right now. It's almost like, it feels like an eternal, what is that movie, Night at the Museum, where, you know, things are maybe going on inside the museum, but you can imagine closed and dark and all that good art.
Pardon me, but I remember you asked me the question recently about, did you think online viewing of art will take on, that's what people will do? I don't think so. I think people love the museum. People want to go in. They want to see the real thing.
I agree with you.
Yeah.
And you're talking about the Sydney Biennale. I really, you know, the way you describe it, I would love to be able to go there. And a lot of us are sort of thinking, wow, go there is something that we might have to not do for a little bit. And, you know, we might only be able to see it from afar. And so it's good that, you know, if you're not in Sydney, that you can maybe see it on your computer and yeah. enjoy it likewise. So you have the option, and I agree with you. It's not the same, but at least there's an option. And, you know, so I'm going to jump right into Bass Squared. Bass Squared is the Bass's online art gallery.
Yep.
We don't show pictures of art that exists in gallery. We show art in its form inside our gallery. So that's the distinction. But you have a very tight relationship with Miami as well.
Yes, yes.
And that's kind of how we got to...
Oh, yes. The wonderful patrons, Marty and Cricket Taplin, who owned the stunning Sagamore Hotel right there in Miami on the beach. And they were very generous with artists and would invite me down to stay in the hotel. They bought my work. They bought the montages that you're showing and have donated them to Bass Museum. And so that's my connection, you know, and it was such a treat. Oh, we're talking 10 years ago now. Would we? Yeah, possibly. Yeah. I 2011. I think it was the last time. It was such a joy to have your work shown in the lobby of a hotel. You know, I'm never a snob about anything. You know, it doesn't matter. Show the work. It doesn't matter where.
Absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, create the connections. They were showing their work in the lobby. You were there. We all got to meet, and then happy stories happen because they end up donating it to the Bass, and then you donated two other ones so that we could have the full collection, and
yes.
So appreciative of that. So you are our exhibition right now in the Bass Squared, and we're going to show a clip of the montage series, which is 1999 to 2015. Before we start talking about it.
Okay.
How about art?
Art? That's a good subject. You started off.
You started off. I don't know anything about it.
Well, what do you want to know about it?
Are you gambling on my timeline?
Excuse me.
It's great to see us rest our bones for a minute.
Well, these white folks are falling for every trick in the book.
So Tracy, I want to ask you about the montages. It looks like every single one of them goes through a full range of emotion. And I'm going to simplify this, you know, like, you know, too simple, but it's sort of like love, hate, love in general. And let's start with mother. I want to start with mother because it was Mother's Day this weekend. And we sent out a really beautiful Mother's Day salute to everyone, and we included it. And we got people weeping and mothers calling me and texting me and saying it was the most beautiful thing they've ever seen.
Yeah.
Tell us about Mother.
Oh, it kills me. How many clips I used? 200 clips of movies depicting motherhood, scenes of mothers, funny mothers, terrible mothers, mothers that slap you across the face, hateful mothers, gorgeous mothers, mother and daughter. Oh, there's a powerful thing, isn't it? The mother and daughter relationship. The famous clip from the Ingmar Bergman film, it's from Autumn Sonata. Ingrid Bergman, Liv Ullmann. And what's the famous line about the umbilical cord between the mother and daughter is never, it's never broken. It's always just there. It's very, very powerful. Yes, yes.
It is.
Some of those
The scenes are really powerful, and I had no idea it was 200. It's amazing to hear that. I remember kind of funny clips as well, when the character of Rhoda is not allowing her mother to walk in, and the mother keeps putting her hand inside the door and trying to unclip the chain lock. And then finally she gets this big wrench.
Excuse me, it's Barbara Streisand. Please get the star right. Not Rhoda.
Oh, okay.
That's a Barbara Streisand film. What's up, Doc? Yes.
And that was so funny, just so funny. But also you have, let's talk about Doomed. I mean, I don't want to be too catastrophic and I don't want to say, well, we're doomed, but let's talk about Doomed a little bit.
Yes, it's a disaster. It's every movie of a tidal wave, an earthquake, cyclones, tornadoes, all cut together to music. And it's sort of operatic. Is that the word? Operatic?
It's very operatic.
Over the top.
It's over the top, and you almost feel like running to it, like, you know, doing exercise or something, because it's really coming at you really fast. But let's go back to love, because there's Love, which is beautiful. And then you have Love. I watched it last night again. And there's a lot of violence in Love.
It's violent. Oh, yeah.
It's complex.
It is. Oh, yes, yes, yes. Because it's often like that, I think. It's another twist on Love, let's just say. Let's just say, without giving it away, the ladies bring up the guns in the end.
Boom, yes. Boom. I was going to ask you about that. So
boom,
it's sort of, the end is so it goes through the whole cycles of love and violent love and all of that. But then there's this feminist, I won't take this anymore scenes. Do you want to talk about that?
Oh, yes. Like the scene from Thelma and Louise where they blow up the guy's truck. Yeah, sure. Look, I mean, I put them together with this wonderful collaborator, Gary Hilberg, who has a collection of 2,000 films. And there was a lot of back and forth with that one. It took almost over a period of 12 months to put that together. But I had to go to places like that, you know. So the violence disturbs a lot of people. Oh, well.
Oh, well.
Oh, well. Yeah.
And,
you know, very, very intense emotions. I am Scorpio.
Oh, okay. Scorpios and intense go in the same sentence? tell us about your collaboration with Gary Hilberg, which is somebody you always bring up when we talk about the montages.
Because I think with making these sort of crazy Hollywood clip films, you need a collaborator. You can't do it by yourself. You need to discuss certain films with I think I'm pretty good with film knowledge, but he's better. And there's no way I could have put them together myself. He's a sort of springboard. I come up with the concepts and he edits them. And we did them 12,000 miles apart. I was in New York and he was in Melbourne. And we never really sat in the one room and cut the pieces together. It was all by telephone and notes. We couldn't, he didn't like me to even be beside him. Once I was beside him, we did some clips of Mother, and I could tell he felt uncomfortable. Yeah. You honestly need to be working with others, I think, on this sort of work.
And, you know, you were working similar to a lot of people are working these days, where you're working and you're sending things and things are coming back. There's a lot of collaboration like that, not only in the arts, but also in the music business, where it's sort of long distance and everybody's working in that same matter. But I want to ask you, you said uncomfortable. You said it twice in relation to your video. And I've been thinking about discomfort, and I've been talking about it a lot. And I want to hear what you have to say about discomfort, especially now. One of the things that I've been telling my staff is it's okay to be uncomfortable. We need to be uncomfortable for a minute here. Mm. This is where we are. So tell me what you think.
The state of the world at the moment and the isolation, is that's what it's good for everybody to be isolated for a while. Everything just got too much. The world got too all this crazy travel, everyone jumping on planes. And also, I like not having to hug and kiss people all the time. Let's like go bye-bye, you know, for a little while. Just stay, you know, 6 feet away. I think it's good for humanity at the moment to have a think about ourselves and take the time to enjoy nature and read and I'm sorry a lot of people are out of work, but it's uncomfortable, like you said, it's discomfort, I guess. It's a period. But I think it's not bad for a lot of people.
So are you doing anything? Have you taken up a new hobby? Are you doing anything that this isolation might have opened up a space in your life to take on? Anything new?
I'm secretly just, nothing's changed for me. I'm still working on my art. I work from home. This is my apartment, my studio, and nothing's changed. I'm still printing large prints and sticking them up all over the wall, running to the photo lab, picking up the new test print. They leave the prints for me outside the door. It's business as usual, actually. Mm. And, you know, we work all the time. Artists work all the time. And I told you the story about meeting Philip Glass, the great composer in New York many years ago. It was winter. We were in at a party, looking out the window, watching the snow come down. And I said to him, Philip, do you work better in when it's cold and it's wintertime? You're inside a lot. And do you find that's a better time for you to work? And he said, I work all the time.
Hmm. Of course.
There's no time to work. It's just all the time.
Wow. So I want to end my I guess, questions about montages, talking about art and artists. Are they self-portraits, these montages?
The frustration, the one with the artist destroying their work? Oh, I love that one. Oh, yes, of course. Yes, yes, yes. We always want to let's smash the glass and kick our art around. I remember the great artist Louise Bourgeois used to do that. She'd smash her sculptures. There's a documentary of her smashing up a sculpture. And after she's toppled it onto the floor and it crashes, she goes, oh, there it is. Like the release. There's kind of like a release in her. Oh, I've smashed it. How great. Let it go. Let it go. It's not working. What's her famous quote? I do, I undo, I redo. That's how you make art. I do, I redo. I undo, I redo, I redo, I undo. It's something, it's three things. It's a famous quote from her. Back and forth. So that the frustration in that the art video is very real. Yes, it's yes.
So you have destroyed art. Have you ever smashed art?
Oh yeah, so good. Feels good. With a sledgehammer.
With a sledgehammer.
Yeah.
Oh, that sounds amazing. So we are asking for questions. Tracey, would you like to say, is there any question that I haven't asked you?
No, it's just meant to be a chat. It's nothing, you know, formal. It is Miami after all.
It is. So we are opening it up to our Facebook friends and people watching to see if you have they have any questions for you.
All right.
And I am getting whatever question comes in. So let's chat about something else.
Sydney's great. I mean, it's a beautiful place to be isolated because we have these, I live on the harbour and there's beautiful parks to walk, you know, lots of walking. I love that.
So I think a lot of people have been walking. It's something that is sort of, I guess, pacing our days in a good way. Some people that are able to walk outside, of course, are walking, and walking and talking is a good thing.
Yeah. Yes. I've been meeting with artist friends. We social distance at the coffee shop, you know, stand up coffee. And they're all working. Everyone I know is still working. It's a perfect time if you're isolated.
Is Sydney closed?
It's quiet time.
But the businesses are open, correct?
Coffee shops?
Businesses.
Some of them are reopening. Restaurants tomorrow are allowed to open and seat, I think, 10 people. There's a limit to the amount of people that can sit in the restaurant.
So I'm...
Touch wood. Australia's doing all right, you know, and so is New Zealand.
So I'm getting a question by text from Vivian Pfeiffer, who is asking you, what would be your dream exhibition, where and why?
Oh, please. That's a... Well, I don't think anyone could go past MoMA. Mm. You know, I mean, that would be amazing. Although I had my films show in MoMA, but I haven't had my photography show yet. Although they do have my work in their collection, but that would be certainly a pinnacle in my career to MoMA.
MoMA. Yep, we got it. I have a second question for you from Daphne Starr. Tracey, what do you do to stay calm and relaxed when you're not creating art?
Watch television. No, I do have a life. I go to the beach. I enjoy nature. I enjoy friends and family. I've given up margaritas and any form of alcohol, so that doesn't count anymore. And I've given up, I have a few cigarettes at night, which I've given up too now because I'm terrified. So it's just nature walks.
That's really lovely. I have a last question from Ellen Schweber. Please.
Hi, Ellen.
Please tell Tracey it's great to see her, sending my very best. Also, Tracey, who is selling your videos?
My art dealer, Tyler Rollins in New York, and Roslyn Oxley Gallery in Sydney. Hi, Alan, darling. One of my first collectors in New York.
Oh, that's beautiful that we can connect like that.
Yes.
Have another question from my friend Veronica Alvarez, who says, Tracey, how many movies have you watched in your lifetime? Do you watch them fully to do your work, mostly classics?
Oh, yes, of course. I don't half watch anything. I could never ever remember how many movies I've watched in my lifetime. I remember the first film I ever saw in the cinema, Mary Poppins.
Mary Poppins is the first one?
The first film I ever saw, age 5, yes. I think it influenced a lot of my visual work, the coloration, the Disney-esque Technicolor, you know. Very vivid in my memory, seeing Mary Poppins on the big screen.
So a lot of people are really curious about what you're watching and what you're doing. I don't know if people, you know, really want to know the source of your inspiration, but I have a question from Andrea Lajos. Hi, Tracey. What are you watching these days? TV shows, movies?
I've been lately binge watching TV series. The last one we're right now is Vida. Vida, did you watch Vida?
No, I didn't.
With the Latina girls in LA who set up the bar?
No, but I
VIDA. It's a great series. I get addicted. I get addicted, you know, to The Sopranos, or I think now television is better than cinema.
Yeah.
TV series. Yeah. The HBO. Years ago, I loved Rome. Did you ever see Rome? It's so well done. HBO and a BBC production. Really brilliant British actors. And it was the depiction of Rome was so shocking. Pagan, lots of sex. Rome is depicted as this filthy place full of graffiti and chickens running in the street, and as opposed to the Hollywood Rome that we know of. So, yeah.
So
I'm addicted to, I love the History Channel as well, and Discovery. You know, I love documentary, a big documentary fan, actually.
So I have another question coming in, but I want to ask you one of my own. Do you ever think you'll take up the montages again and create a new series of montages?
I don't know. I'm not sure. I've been, it might be an art form that I'll leave alone for a while, I think. There are other legal reasons. Perhaps I shouldn't be playing with, anyway, I won't bring that up, but I think I'll, you in fact have the full set now, Silvia.
Yes, we do. And we're very proud of it.
The first American museum to show them all together.
Oh, that's wonderful. Well, we could be showing them in person at some point, and now they're all on our Bass Squared. So if you haven't seen all of them, I invite you to tune in to Bass Squared on our Instagram gallery, and you'll see them all there. I also want to ask one more question that's coming in before we say goodbye. It's very late for you, and you've been so generous for allowing us to see you. Cynthia Fleischman is asking, what is your typical edition size of photograph and image sizes?
Oh, it varies. It's impossible to answer. But thank you.
Okay, I have a quick last question. My questions are coming at me, so I don't like to leave anybody hanging. Do you prefer working with smaller or bigger galleries?
I actually prefer the smaller ones because it's much more personal.
Mm.
And life is hard enough, and it's stressful enough dealing with New York galleries. I prefer the small ones.
That's my
point. You know, in the end, hopefully you'll get a review. The New York Times will see your show, and that happens. And you'll get an audience. As long as it's New York.
Well, I hope to see you again very soon, Tracey. And as soon as you can get into the Sydney Biennale, can you send me some pictures or write to me or something and tell me what's going on there so that
yeah.
we enjoy it as well? I'll share it with some people. And
yes.
say goodbye. I'd like to thank Cultured Magazine for their support as a media sponsor. And remind you that next Thursday, I will be in conversation with Sylvie Fleury, same time and same place. Thursday
at Cali.
Yes. No, she's in Switzerland, I think. Switzerland. So Tracey, goodbye and good night.
Good night to everybody. That was fun. It was relaxed. Miami.
That's very fun. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.